Welcome guests. It is a distinct honor to host this event tonight in collaboration with the SCA, the Sephardic Community Alliance. To open the evening, I'd like to invite Abe Joe Franco to sing the American National Anthem together with Eliyahu Sion, singing the Hatikva.
ולפצה מזרח קדימה עין לציון צופיה עוד לא עבדה תקוותנו שנות אלפיים להיותם חופשי בארצנו ארץ ציון ירושלים להיותם חופשי
Thank you.
Our synagogue and board has been hosting and producing concerts like we had the Nobel last November, intellectual events with great speakers, rabbis with mind-opening topics and views, political figures such as Malcolm Holmline, we hosted last year, Ambassador Michael Oren this last December, and this evening with emissary diplomat Mr. Dennis Royce. We have many upcoming young talented men in our community blossoming in front of our eyes. In particular, Irv Safdie is actively involved with keeping a close connection with our community and the state of Israel with inside knowledge of affairs happening weekly and daily. Each week, Irv puts together a nice table topics bulletin called the Sabra Report. Irv has put this evening together for us as well. Irv is also well connected. He has been able to bring to our community a man that has served and played significant roles under the administrations of United States presidents from Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan, George H.W. Bush, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, and Barack Obama. Dennis Ross is one of our own and a friend to our people domestically and internationally. A strong advocate to our government and the State of Israel homeland. A man that understands what the State of Israel means to every Jew. I will let Irv elaborate with an introduction for Mr. Ross. Please enjoy the evening. Irv.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Irving Safdie. I write the Sabra Report and the founder of the Sabra Institute. Those are our students back there. You'll be hearing from two of them later this evening, but I would like to delay no further. We're very excited and honored to have Ambassador Ross with here tonight. Judah did an excellent job in describing some of the roles that Ambassador Ross has served in. Obviously, the different administrations, the different presidents they had served, whether it was President Carter, Reagan, H.W. Bush, Clinton, Obama, the different Israeli and Palestinian leaders that he had worked with as well. Ambassador Ross has been involved in the peace process, whether it was the Israeli-Palestinian peace process, the Israeli-Jordanian peace process, the Israeli-Syrian peace process that unfortunately never came to fruition. For his entire life, especially in the public space, he's been devoted to Israeli peace. And we're especially, it's an especially timely opportunity for us to have him here. On the dawn of a new American administration, we have you know, President-elect Trump, who's going to be, his inauguration is next week. So we couldn't be more excited to have you here tonight. We're deeply honored, and take it away, Ambassador Ross. Can we get the wireless mics turned on, please?
Okay. You hear me? Okay. So I teach, and I also like to walk and talk, so that's why I'm doing this. Although I will say, once I appear a lot in college campuses, and I once pulled out the mic like this, and I started walking around, and I said, look, I'm not going to play Phil Donahue. And I drew completely blank looks. But obviously, this audience is a little bit more experienced, so... It is, you know, it's actually true. I was a political appointee for two Republican presidents, Reagan and the first Bush, and two Democratic presidents, Bill Clinton and Barack Obama. And you know what that makes me? An extinct species. So I am here on the eve of a new president being inaugurated, and I should say, before we came down here tonight, I met with students upstairs, and their questions were really excellent. They reflected maybe what you've been doing, Irv. I mean, they reflected, obviously, kids who were paying an awful lot of attention. They asked the right kind of questions. They asked me about the Security Council resolution. They asked me about the embassy being moved. The nature of the questions were very thoughtful. They also asked me about the kind of things that Trump would do, and I said, I don't know. And I'm not going to tell you tonight that I know what he's going to do. I don't think anybody can tell you what he's going to do, but what I will do, I'll tell you what he's going to confront in the Middle East. You know, I did a book, my most recent book is a book called Doomed to Succeed, the U.S.-Israeli Relationship from Truman to Obama. And I go through every administration, every president, from Truman to Obama. I look at what were the key assumptions in each of those administrations. Was there unanimity or division within those administrations? What were the key events that played out in the Middle East in those administrations? How do the key assumptions reflect themselves in terms of those key events? And I will tell you, every single one of those administrations, from Truman to Obama, had in the Middle East one major war and or one major crisis. Okay, every single one. And what I'll tell you is that Trump and his administration will face a more complicated, more challenging Middle East than any of his predecessors. And that's a pretty bald statement, right? Because I just told you, every president from Truman to Obama faced at least one major war and one major crisis. And yet, what Trump is going to face is more daunting. And I want to explain that statement. He's going to face a region that is characterized by challenges to the state system itself, something that we haven't seen before. I mean, if you look at Syria and Iraq, Yemen and Libya, these are four states that probably will never really be put back together again. In Syria, he's going to inherit a war that will still be going on. The Russians are now trying to produce a ceasefire, which has generally been holding. They did a deal with Turkey, by the way, and the Iranians, and they brought Assad in after the fact. The ceasefire is mostly holding, not completely holding, but it does nothing to deal with ISIS, because the truth is the Russians haven't been fighting ISIS. 90% of the bombs that they dropped have been on the non-ISIS Syrian opposition. So Trump will come in a war that won't go away. The reason it won't go away is because ISIS is still there and because Assad is still there. 500,000 people are dead in Syria. More than 1 million are wounded. Out of a population of 23 million, 12 million people have been displaced, 4 to 5 million outside the region, and the remainder or outside Syria, and the remainder in Syria itself, living in conditions that are hard to imagine. The country will need, at a minimum, $300 billion in terms of reconstruction assistance, at a minimum. That's not going to materialize from any place easily or quickly. Trump has talked about working with the Russians to fight against ISIS. The one big problem with doing that, if you're joining with the Russians in Syria, is that Russia has basically empowered Iran within Syria. The head of the Revolutionary Guard's Quds forces is a guy named Qasem Soleimani. And he appeared in Aleppo the week before last. This is a guy who used to be a completely shadowy figure. The Quds forces of the Revolutionary Guard are basically the kind of action arm of the Revolutionary Guard in Iran. He used to always be a shadowy figure. Starting last year in Ramadi in Iraq, when they were fighting, the Shia militia were fighting against ISIS there, and then in Fallujah, suddenly he appears on the ground. He also appeared around Tikrit. The fact was, it was American bombs that forced ISIS out in Tikrit. But in both Ramadi and Fallujah, the Shia militias played a major role. And in Aleppo, they played a major role. And the reason they play a major role is because the Syrians today have a very small number of forces that are actually deployable. At the beginning of the war in Syria, Syria had a military of 400,000. Doesn't mean the whole military force was all deployable, but more than half of that number was deployable. Anybody have a guess as to how many deployable forces today Syria has? Take a guess. I say they had, the beginning of the war, they had an army, a military of 400,000. More than half of that was deployable, say 225,000. What do you think they have today? 30,000? No, it's 20,000. Now, the reason they depend upon the Shia militias, Iran, Hezbollah uses all the Shia militias. The Shia militias have come from as far away as Afghanistan. This is a tool of the Iranians. The reason that they depend on that is because the Syrian military doesn't have the manpower to take and hold territory. So they shift forces around. So if you're working with the Russians, you're abetting Iranian military power. One of the things that the Iranians want to do in Syria is to create a new front against Israel on the Golan Heights. So one of the things that I hope will change in a Trump administration when he contends with Syria is that he'll understand that if you want to work with the Russians, you need to exert leverage on them, and they have to separate themselves from the Iranians. But a major challenge he's going to face, I mentioned ISIS, but I didn't say about liberating ISIS, liberating Raqqa, which is the capital of the so-called Islamic State in Syria. One of the early challenges will be, what do you do about ISIS there? Who replaces them? If you rely upon the Shia militia, you may be able to defeat ISIS in the near term, but you will recreate the conditions that produced ISIS in the first place. And when I mentioned that Qasem Soleimani showed up in Ramadi and Fallujah, I can tell you who didn't show up in Fallujah and Ramadi. All the young Sunni males disappeared. So when you depend on the Shia militia, you deepen sectarianism. And when you deepen the sectarianism, you do two things. One, you create an exclusion of Sunnis. You create an alienation of Sunnis, which is what produced the appeal of ISIS in the first place. And the second thing you do, there is a basic struggle for power in the Middle East, mostly over identity, mostly between radical Islamists and non-Islamists, but certainly a subcomponent of that is Sunnis versus Shia. If you look like you're aligning with the Iranians, then you're not aligning with the Sunnis. And you need the Sunnis to fight ISIS, because ISIS is Sunni. You need the Sunnis to replace ISIS, because you need manpower to replace them, and only the Sunnis can do that. You need the Sunnis to provide governance after ISIS is gone. You need the Sunni moneyed state to provide the reconstruction assistance that you're going to need. So this is a president who's going to confront big needs, new requirements for decisions on Syria very quickly. Now, I would tell you, if that was the only thing he was confronting in the Middle East, it would be Dianan. It would be enough. In fact, it would be more than enough, but it's not the only thing. If you're reading about what's going on in Iraq, you're seeing that Mosul has not yet been taken back, although the Iraqi military is now making progress, more progress than it has recently in Mosul. But the same challenges I was just describing in Syria as it relates to Raqqa exist in Mosul. The Iraqi military, which is being backed by our forces, we're using air assets, logistics support, we're moving their forces around, we're providing intelligence to them, and they are using they're using part of their military and part of what are their crack terrorism, basically anti-terrorism, counterterrorism units, which we have trained on the ground in Mosul. There are Shia militias that they haven't allowed into Mosul, but they're all around Mosul in the suburbs. There's a suburb called Talabad, and there they're very active, and the same pattern is being replayed there. They're looting, the Sunni males are disappearing, all the same things that contributed to the emergence of ISIS in the first place within Iraq, they're doing there. Now the challenge of what happens after you liberate Mosul is going to be something that confronts the administration probably within its first 2 to 3 months. What is the strategy for that? You know, President-elect Trump has said, and he said it again in his press conference this past week, that President Obama was responsible for the rise of ISIS because we left Iraq. Well, one thing I can assure you, President Trump won't want to be responsible for is the defeat of ISIS now, and within his first term, the reemergence of Son of ISIS, whether it's in Iraq or it's in Syria. These are really daunting kinds of challenges. Because you've got to find a way to replace them, you've got to find a way to create inclusion for Sunnis, you've got to find a way to create reconstruction, you have to create a stake for the Sunnis so they feel they have something to gain. And you need the Sunni states for that. If it looks like you're somehow lining up with the Iranians, even indirectly, because of working with the Russians in a way that the Russians are not separating themselves from the Iranians, then you're going to have a problem. These are pretty complicated issues. Now, so far I've talked only about Syria and Iraq. We have a proxy war in Yemen between, effectively, Saudi Arabia and Iran. About 3 weeks ago, the King of Saudi Arabia gave a speech in which he said, we will not allow Iran to create a beachhead on our border. And the Iranians see providing support to the Houthis, which are a Shia-based tribe in Yemen. The Iranians see this as a simple way to bleed the Saudis. Well, that conflict's not going away. And, you know, it exists right along the mouth of the Red Sea. So we have an interest in what goes on there. And then there's Egypt. Egypt is a country of 93 million. Egypt got a standby loan from the IMF, and yet Egypt has a shortage right now of rice, of cooking oil, and of sugar. Those are staples. How long do you think you have stability in Egypt if you don't address those kinds of issues? We cannot afford for Egypt to become a failed or a failing state. I said, it has a population of 93 million. The population of Syria was 23 million. You see what the impact of the war in Syria has produced in Europe. What do you think the impact would be in Europe, the region, and even on us, if Egypt became a failed state? We literally cannot afford for Egypt to become a failed or failing state. But it isn't enough to say that. You're going to have a strategy to deal with it. And that, too, by itself, if you didn't have Syria, if you didn't have Iraq, if you didn't have Yemen, Egypt alone would be a huge challenge for the new administration. So now that I'm thoroughly depressing you, I should find a way to provide something that's a little bit uplifting, right? All right, I haven't mentioned Libya, but I don't want to further depress you, so I'm not going to mention Libya. But I do want to note one thing. As difficult as this environment is, and it is, it's really a daunting, complicated environment, and the ability to fashion a strategy for it depends upon understanding it. That's the starting point. But there are two developments in this region that create potential assets for the new administration, significant assets for the new administration, for contending with what I just described. The first one is that there actually is a convergence of strategic interests between Israel and all the Sunni Arab states. It's not the first time there's been the appearance of that. If you read my book and you read the chapter on Reagan, you'll see when Alexander Haig became Secretary of State in 1981, he said there's a strategic realignment in the region. And he said the strategic realignment came from the fact that there had been a revolution in Iran, 1979, and that had created a threat to the Sunni Arab states, and not just the Sunni Arab states, but the Arab states in general. And that gave them a common interest with Israel, and the threat from the Soviet Union gave them a common interest with Israel. Now, what he said in 1981 was theoretically right. It just wasn't practically right. That theoretical convergence didn't translate into a practical convergence and practical cooperation. But today it has. Today, the level of cooperation between Israel and Egypt and Jordan, completely unprecedented. Mostly below the radar screen, but what they do in security and intelligence, we've never seen before. And by the way, the same thing exists between Israel and the states in the Arabian Peninsula. They keep it below the radar screen because the Palestinian issue is still an issue that creates a resonance among their public, and they feel defensive about working overtly with Israel, but that doesn't make what they're doing with Israel any less real. Now, this didn't happen because the Obama administration made a conscious decision to produce it. Quite the contrary. The Obama administration did help to produce it, but not by design. The Obama administration helped to produce it because what the Israelis and the Sunni Arab states all felt was the same thing. They read, fairly or not, that Obama looked at Iran as being basically the way to solve the problems of the region as opposed to being the source of the problems in the region. And for them, Iran was the source of the problems in the region. And that convergence of strategic interest because of the way they perceived a common threat has produced very practical cooperation between them. Now that's a real asset. This is something the new administration can actually build on. It can be used to deal with the threat the Iranians pose, which is not just what they do on their own, but the way they are using Shia militias. I said in Syria today, they are drawing on Shia militias from as far away as Afghanistan. It's not just that they use Hezbollah in a significant way in Syria. It's that they're using a series of Shia militias from Iraq, and they're using them from beyond. And they're using Shia militias as a lever, as a threat on every Arab regime. Well, think of what you can do with the Israelis and the Arab states working together to be a counter to that. One of the things I've suggested, we'll see if it's greeted with receptivity or not, we should be doing contingency planning with the Israelis and the Arab states. It can be done discreetly, where we focus on developing a set of options for how you counter the Shia militias. Getting the Israelis and the Arab states to work together against Iran and the Shia militias in the region is a tremendous asset for the new administration that didn't exist in the past. That's a very positive thing. Now there's a second element to this. The potential for using the cooperation between Israelis and Arab states on the Palestinian issue exists, not to be a substitute for the Palestinians, because they won't substitute for the Palestinians, but to be a cover for the Palestinians. Today, the Palestinians won't negotiate. Today, the Palestinians treat negotiations as if they're a concession. Talking to Israel is a concession. Well, if talking to Israel is a concession, you think they can make any concessions when they talk? They need a cover. Why? because they are weak, they're divided, and there's a succession process underway to Abu Mazen. Do you think during periods of succession this produces greater moderation? During succession, everybody competes to see who can be more pure, who can be more extreme, not who can be more moderate. So the combination of the weakness, the division, and the prospect of succession are all contributing to making it highly unlikely the Palestinians on their own can do anything. But maybe with an Arab cover, they could do something. But the Arab cover applies to the Israelis as well. The body politic in Israel today doesn't believe you get anything from the Palestinians if you concede something to the Palestinians. So if they're going to concede something to the Palestinians, if they're going to get something, they want to get it from the Arabs. So suddenly, you have the potential, given what's going on with this new relationship, you actually have the potential to have the Arabs play a role on the Israeli-Palestinian issue as well. On the one hand, this may be the key to being able to counter the Iranians and what they're doing in the region. On the other hand, it could be useful on the Palestinian issue. I say could. I don't know if it can be. I think you have to probe this. If I were doing what I used to do, I'd be going to the Arab leaders, and in private I'd be saying to them, what would you need from the Israelis to be providing that kind of cover for the Palestinians? And I'd be going to the Israelis and I would say, what would you need from the Arabs to be able to make the kind of moves they would need for you to take vis-a-vis the Palestinians? What I wouldn't be doing, and what I don't advise the Trump administration to do, is launching a big public initiative. The greatest single problem between Israelis and Palestinians today is complete lack of belief. There's complete disbelief on both sides towards each other. What you don't need is a big failed initiative. And if you push something big in public, first of all, the minute you push it in public, you require everybody to adopt their most maximal positions. Once you adopt maximal positions in public, not very easy to back off of them. So what is needed is not a big public initiative. What is needed is private efforts to try to restore belief and private probing to see what the Arabs might be prepared to do. But I go back to what I said. Against this array of very daunting challenges, you have what is a new development, and it has significant potential. So that's one of the new developments. There's a second one. In Saudi Arabia today, there's a national transformation plan. I was there at the end of August. I met the entire Saudi leadership, the king, the crown prince, deputy crown prince, seven ministers. One of them said to me, welcome to our revolution disguised as economic reform. There is a revolution taking place in Saudi Arabia right now. It isn't just what they're trying to do economically, although it's driven by that. You know, you take Aramco, the national oil company, and they're going to produce an initial public offering, meaning they're going to take part of Aramco and bring it public, which means you have to open the books. Well, it can't be the private piggy bank of the royal family any longer. They have taken on the religious police. The religious police can no longer detain, arrest, or interrogate anyone. And the religious police are no longer allowed to go into the Saudi malls. When this was done, it actually sort of turned the Twitter sphere into, you know, into like a massive outpouring. I mean, in Saudi Arabia today, 70% of the population is under the age of 30. The highest per capita use of Twitter on the planet is in Saudi Arabia. Turns out Trump could be very comfortable there. They are overhauling the whole educational system in Saudi Arabia. You know, the steps that they are taking constitute something very dramatic. I don't know if they can succeed, because the religious establishment has a vested interest in not changing. Certainly, significant parts of the royal family have a vested interest in not changing. The subsidies that have been a natural part of life in Saudi Arabia have been cut. There was, basically, people never used to have to pay for electricity or water. Now they do. The wages, the salaries of the people in the government have all been cut. So they'll face opposition to this, but we have an enormous stake in their success. Why? There has never been a successful model of development in the Arab world. I'm going to repeat that. There has never been a successful model of development in the Arab world. That's the reason you have a constant stream of pretenders. Secular nationalists like Nasser, to the Islamists like the Muslim Brotherhood. What's the slogan of the Muslim Brotherhood? Islam is the answer. What is it they've all been pretending to do? They've all been saying, we'll be the ones to restore greatness lost. This is a region that lagged behind. In 1960, Egypt and South Korea had the same GDP. Today, South Korea has a GDP of the whole region. They have been left behind, and they know they've been left behind, and that is a source of a lot of the instability. And you have this constant struggle to see, well, who's going to be the hero? In 1955, Nasser wrote a book called The Philosophy of the Revolution, and he described what he called, there's a role in search of a hero. He was going to be the hero. Well, he wasn't. But either have any of the pretenders since that time, and none of them can be, whether they're secularists, as you saw in the past, or the Islamists that you see today, or ISIS. You know, you're going to reconcile Islam with modernity by turning back to the 7th century? I don't think so. So having the Saudis actually succeed in creating a successful model of development or modernization means something not only for Saudi Arabia, but for the region itself. And here again, this is a potential asset for the new administration. But it has to understand what's going on. It has to read the landscape right. And to be fair to the incoming administration, we don't have a really good track record in the Middle East. You know, I start off by talking about my book, Doomed to Succeed. Well, there have been three assumptions that have been embedded in the national security apparatus of the United States from Truman's time through Obama. And I guarantee it's part of the apparatus today. These assumptions, they weren't always equal in every administration, but they existed in every administration. These three assumptions were, one, if you distance from Israel, you'll gain with the Arabs. Two, corollary, if you cooperate with Israel, you'll lose with the Arabs. And three, if you want to fix the region and you want to fix the American position in the region, you have to solve the Palestinian issue. These three assumptions have basically been embedded in the psychology. I don't want to go on forever because I realize there's probably a trap door up here. It opens up, I disappear. But I want to go through these three assumptions, how they played out, and I want to say what they reflect about not understanding the region, but what we should understand about the region and what I hope the Trump administration will understand about the region so it can take advantage of what I've been identifying. All right, so let's take the first assumption. If you distance from Israel, you will gain with the Arabs. Five different administrations pursued that very consciously. Eisenhower, Nixon, Carter, the first Bush, and Obama. And I won't go through chapter and verse. You have to read the book to go through chapter and verse of what each of them did to try to distance with the expectation they would gain. But let me just say, let me just focus on Obama. I won't focus on Eisenhower. Eisenhower was the worst, by far. I mean, Eisenhower, all right, I'll digress for a minute. Eisenhower thought that Truman had recognized Israel only for domestic political reasons. Why do you think that? Because the entire national security establishment, all the so-called wise men, there was actually a book called The Wise Men, these are the ones who built the institutions of the Cold War. George C. Marshall, who was the Secretary of State. Forrestal, who was Secretary of Defense. George Kennan, the author of Containment. Kennan and Loy Henderson, there's an auditorium in the State Department named for Loy Henderson. Kennan and Loy Henderson wrote a memo in January of 1948 after we had voted for the partition plan on November 29, 1947, laying out why we had to reverse our position and support trusteeship. Every single one of the people around Truman was against recognition of the State of Israel. Moshe Charette came to see George C. Marshall the week before the end of the mandate, when Ben-Gurion was resolved to go ahead and declare a state. And Marshall told Charette, you can't declare a state. be a disaster, can't declare it, you know, there'll be a war, you're going to lose a war, there should be a trusteeship. Charette came back and saw Ben-Gurion report on this, and he said that Charette's instinct was that Israel shouldn't declare it, that they weren't Israel at that point, that the yeshiv shouldn't declare itself a state. And Ben-Gurion asked him, he said, okay, I understand that, but I'd ask you not to say that. I want you to promise me that when I convene everybody, you won't say that. And Charette agreed not to say that. Because Ben-Gurion understood if Israel didn't declare itself then, there would always be reasons why it couldn't. Truman recognized over the opposition of all of these so-called white men. Eisenhower said, well, what could possibly explain it other than domestic political factors, ignoring the reality that the Jews had actually built the state with no help from us. Truman recognized a state. The minute they recognized a state, they were invaded by all their neighbors. And what was our reaction at the time? Anybody know? We had an arms embargo. Now, the arms embargo started actually on December 5th, 1947, but it wasn't lifted. We didn't provide arms in the Truman administration. We didn't provide arms in Eisenhower, even though the Soviets began to provide massive arms to Egypt, Syria, and Iraq. And every time during the Eisenhower administration that the Israelis would come and make a request for arms, they were told, I'm quoting, you should seek the goodwill of your neighbors, which was rich because all their neighbors rejected their existence. Now, I said Eisenhower was the worst. Obama, in his first 6 months, of the Obama administration, I had made a decision, which if you read the Obama chapter, you'll see I explain. I had made a decision not to go to the White House at the beginning of the administration because I thought the real issue was Iran. I wanted to work on Iran, I wanted to go with, and I thought the real action would be with Clinton. So I went with Clinton for the first 6 months I worked on Iran. I didn't have any responsibility on the Israeli-Palestinian issue. And in retrospect, it was probably a mistake. Because the president asked me to come to the White House. He didn't ask me, he told me I was coming to the White House in July of 2009. But in those first 6 months while I was working on Iran, what were we doing? We adopted a position on settlements that called for a complete settlement freeze, including natural growth, which no Israeli prime minister, left or right, had ever adopted. Why did the president adopt that? Because he wanted to signal how different he was from Bush, and he thought one way to signal how different he was from Bush was to create distance from Israel, and he felt creating distance from Israel on settlements was a good thing to do because the settlements were wrong and it wouldn't affect Israel's security. And then he gave a speech in Cairo. And he didn't go to Israel afterwards. Why? Because he was distancing from Israel. One of the five administrations to distance from Israel with the expectation that by distancing you would gain with the Arabs. Only the five administrations that distanced from Israel never did gain with the Arabs. That's assumption number one. Assumption number two, the corollary. If you cooperate with Israel, you lose with the Arabs. Now, there's a lot of different examples I can give of that too, but I'm going to give you the one that is the most compelling one. I said Truman didn't provide arms to Israel. Eisenhower didn't provide arms to Israel. The first president to provide arms to Israel is Kennedy. Even though Kennedy comes in, the Eisenhower administration had done everything the, quote, in a sense, those who want to focus exclusively on the Arabs wanted. And when Kennedy came in, his view was, boy, are we in a mess in the region. Didn't exactly pay off. Now, Kennedy decides in 62 that there's an imbalance in arms. And the imbalance in arms is going to make war more likely. So he thinks, in fact, what we need to do is we need to provide arms to Israel. Now the arms he wants to provide are exclusively defensive because they're Hawk anti-aircraft missiles. They're fixed batteries. You can't move them. So they're good only against incoming aircraft. Now his readiness to consider this triggered a debate within his administration. When I was doing the research for this chapter, I went back and I read all the cables coming in from our embassies about what should be done, whether or not the president should go ahead with these arms. I described these cables as the Chicken Little cables, because if we provide the arms, the sky is going to fall. It's a uniform position. I'm understating the language that's in them. Dean Rusk was the Secretary of State, and he represented that position to the president. And he said, and I'm quoting now, if you make the decision to provide the Hawk missiles to Israel, you will set a terrible precedent, and you will cause grave damage to our position in the Middle East. Grave damage to our position in the Middle East. Now, as luck would have it, the day the news of the arms sale to Israel became public was the same day that Rusk was meeting at the opening of the UN General Assembly the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, who at the time was Crown Prince Faisal, who in fact at that time was the real putative leader of Saudi Arabia. So the news of this is out. So what does he face? I mean, he just said, you know, this caused grave damage to the relationship with the Arab. So what did he face when he went to see Faisal? Did Faisal say, I can't talk to you because you just provided arms to the Israelis? Did Faisal do the diplomatic equivalent of saying, you're dead to us now? Is that what Faisal did? What do you think?
How much arms did we get?
Well, obviously, if he'd done that, I would have written a different book, so. Faisal doesn't raise the issue. What does Faisal raise? Faisal raises the coup in Yemen, which is backed by Nasser, he says, with the express purpose of Nasser trying to gain a foothold on the Arabian Peninsula to threaten Saudi Arabia. What does Faisal ask for? He asks for American arms and American assurances. So these American arms to Israel, which were supposed to cause grave damage, in fact, what does it produce? A request for American arms to Saudi Arabia. Now, 1 week later, Faisal comes to see President Kennedy in the Oval Office. Now, he's had a week go by. Maybe, you know, he thought, you know, it's like the guy who says, oh, I should have had a V8. He says, how could I go and spend that time with Rusk, and how could I not have raised the Israeli arms? What was I thinking? Now I have this opportunity. I got to raise it with Kennedy. So is that what he does? No, it's not what he does. What does he do? He raises the outreach to Egypt. When Kennedy came in and saw what was happening in the region, he said, look, I'm not going to compete with the Soviets in arms in Egypt, but I'm going to compete for Nasser, who he had a guy named Robert Comer, who was on his National Security Council staff, who described Nasser at the time as king of the Arabs. And so he decides, I'll compete with the Russians by providing economic assistance to Nasser. By the time of this meeting, we are providing 2/3 of Egypt's bread supply. And Faisal comes in and sees the president, and he says, the problem is your outreach to Egypt. Your economic assistance to Egypt is freeing up resources for them to threaten all your friends and change the balance of power in the region. That sound familiar to you? Sound like maybe something you've heard lately? Sound like maybe if you substitute the word Iran for Egypt, that's exactly what the Saudis and others have been saying for the last couple of years? The reason that the Saudis and others were against the Iranian armed nuclear deal, the reason they were against it, they didn't focus on the nuclear question as being an existential threat the way Israel did, because they look at what Iran does on the ground as the existential threat. And they said, gee, if they cause this kind of a threat when they're under sanctions, imagine what kind of a threat they can cause when they're not under sanctions. What does it tell you? Well, it should tell you several things. First, it tells you something about the priorities of Arab leaders. The priority is their security and their survival. They were never going to make their relationship with the United States dependent upon our relationship with Israel. Why? First, because Israel wasn't the threat to them. And second, because they needed our security guarantees. And they weren't going to do anything to put that at risk. So fast forward to today. Fast forward to Trump. You know, the President Obama went to Saudi Arabia this past May and met with the six heads of the Gulf Cooperation Council. These are the, you know, the Saudis, the Emiratis, the Kuwaitis, the Bahrainis, the Qataris, the Omanis. These are the six leaders of the Gulf Cooperation Council. When the president went there, his objective was to persuade them to do much more in the fight against ISIS. Unlike the title of my book, which is called Doomed to Succeed, his mission was doomed to fail. Not because his objective was the wrong objective. If you listen to what I was saying earlier, it was the right objective. We need the Sunnis if we're going to be able to defeat ISIS. They're the ones who provide the manpower. They're the ones who provide the reconstruction assistance. They're the ones who can actually discredit ISIS. But he was going there, and his focus was on what he thought was the big threat. And what did they think was the big threat? Iran. The day after the summit, there was an article written in Shaq Al-Awsat, the regional newspaper. In Arabic, it means the Middle East. It was written by a leading journalist, Abdul Rahman al-Rashid. He's a managing director of the Al-Arabiya Network, and he writes frequently for Shaq Al-Awsat, and he's very close to Saudi leadership. The day after the summit, what did he write? He wrote that President Obama came there and asked the leaders to acquiesce in Iran's dominance. No, do you think that's what the president said?
No.
No way did Obama say that. But it's what they heard. Because they didn't hear from him an understanding of the threat that they see as existential. If you want them to join with us on ISIS, we have to prove to them we get the nature of the Iranian threat. And this brings me back to what I said. You have to understand the priorities of Arab leaders, not because you have to accept them, but if you want to influence them to do the things we think are important, we have to prove to them we get what are the threats that they see. And we have answers with them, not in place of them, but with them for dealing with it. If this administration is going to effectively deal with the challenges I described at the outset, it has to understand what are their priorities. Now, I did two of the three assumptions, right? I didn't do the third assumption. The third assumption was, you know, you can't fix our position in the region, and you can't fix the region itself unless you solve the Palestinian issue. This assumption is just as wrong as the first two. Now, does it seem strange that I'm the one saying that? Right? I mean, I spent 30 years trying to solve this one. But I never tried to solve it because I thought it was a game changer for the region. I never tried to say, gee, we have to fix this, because if we don't fix this, we can't fix the region. You know, today, if tomorrow, given where I am, if the Moshiach arrived and the Israeli-Palestinian issue could be resolved, would it end the war in Syria? Would it end the war in Iraq? Would it stop the proxy conflict in Yemen? Would it fix Egypt? Would it put Libya back together? Would it change Iran's aspirations in the region? This is not, solving this isn't going to solve the region. Is there a reason to try to solve it? Yeah, there is. There's a reason to try to solve it. It would remove one of the sources of conflict. It would ensure that Israel doesn't become a binational state. If we stay on the track we're on right now, that's where we're headed. You know what the polls of young Palestinians say today? The vast majority of young Palestinians say, let the Israelis stay where they are. Let's just have one person, one vote. You know, can we produce two states anytime soon? No, we can't. But can we be working on this issue in a way that maybe transforms it to the extent that we create the possibility of preserving two states for later on, so Israel doesn't become a binational state? You know what the demographics are today? Israel got out of Gaza. And so therefore, that's good. But the number of Israeli Arabs and the number of Palestinians in the West Bank today represent about 38% of the population of that area, which means that Israeli Jews are about 62%. 6238. Does that begin to concern you about the nature of the Jewish state? So you got to do something. And maybe in the Q&A, I'll describe what I would do. But the point is, there's a reason, if you care about Israel, to do something about this issue. The one thing you can't do is create a false set of choices, a binary choice. You can't say, you know what? If I can't solve the problem, I'll do nothing. Because then it will get worse. You look at the Middle East. If the Trump administration decides it's going to withdraw, it'll feed the vacuums that we've seen. The biggest mistake of the Obama administration was to create a kind of retrenchment, because it contributed to vacuums. And in the Middle East, when you have a vacuum, the worst forces fill it. On this issue between Israelis and Palestinians, if you do nothing, you'll have a vacuum, and the worst forces will fill it. The disbelief will grow greater and greater. So you can't fix it, but you also shouldn't leave it alone. So why did I entitle the book Doomed to Succeed? Because it's a clever title? Okay, it's a clever title. That's not the reason I titled it that. This is a relationship that began at a very low ebb. I described it. Not a single one of the national security advisors around Truman wanted to recognize the state, didn't want the state to be declared. It evolved over time because we share interests and we share values with Israel. The reason I, in a sense, have a title that implies confidence and optimism about the future of the relationship is partly because Israel is the only democracy in the region, but partly also, look at the shape of the region. This is a region that's going to be characterized by really terrible conflict for at least the next 10 years. Even the two developments I talked about, they represent assets to try to contend with the challenges. It doesn't mean the challenges are going away. The reason the violence is so bad in some of these conflicts is because it's over identity. When it's over identity, it's about existence. When it's about existence, there's no limits. Now, in the midst of that turmoil, that uncertainty, these ongoing conflicts, you have one state that, whatever its problems, you have one state that has a rule of law, a separation of powers, an independent judiciary, freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom of the press. You have one state where there are regularly and unregularly scheduled elections, where the loser accepts the outcome. You have one state with a vibrant civil society. You have one state where women's rights are respected. You have one state where gay rights are respected. You know where Palestinian gays go? To Tel Aviv. You have one state that is a state governed by institutions. And whatever its problems, and they're real, whatever its problems, because of those institutions, it has the ability to deal with it. In an atmosphere of great uncertainty, this is not the time to distance from Israel. In an atmosphere where you need stability and predictability, if you didn't have Israel, you'd need to create it. And that's the reason I titled the book, Doomed to Succeed. Okay, I'm going to stop there and I'll take some questions.
Thank you, Mr. Ross. I'd like to invite a member of our Kahal, a man that's very passionate about the state of Israel, Mr. Jack Indy. He's going to ask Mr. Ross some Q&A.
Thank you, Judah. Thank you, Mr. Ross. Hi. So first off, I want to thank everyone who submitted questions to me. I'm going to do my best to read them off in no particular order and give our guests an opportunity to answer them. First question. Anonymously submitted. In a recent quote
Dennis Ross said, and I'm quoting, 80% of the stabbings are by people under the age of 20. I'm talking about stabbings in Israel. The Palestinian Authority is not criticizing it. In fact, Abbas still refers to the stabbers as quote-unquote martyrs. My question, the question, is this a quote-unquote partner for peace? And at what point can we say we have no partner?
Look, obviously, one of the things that has to be done is you have to discredit this kind of violence. The Palestinian Authority has not done that. Although, to be fair, if you look at one of the reasons the what began as and was referred to as the knifing intifada, if you look at what has gone on, the Palestinian Authority has actually sent their security forces into the schools, taken knives out of lockers, gone to those particular areas that have produced more of the individuals, and tried to dissuade them from doing this. But there is still a fundamental problem, which is they have funds where they provide monies to the families of those who get killed trying to kill Israelis. As long as you do that, you're not discrediting it. So if you ask me, are they a partner for peace? I would say today what I said earlier, I don't see any capacity on their part to be able to negotiate peace. I don't see capacity on their part to produce a state right now. So, you know, my answer to you is, I don't think we're on the brink or we're close to being able to produce a two-state outcome. Does that mean I think it's okay that Israel should become a binational state? No. The challenge is, how do you go from where we are, where you can't produce a two-state outcome, because truthfully the Palestinians can't do it, to ensuring that you at least keep open the option that at some point down the road, a two-state option is possible. If you take certain steps on the ground that preclude that, then Israel will be a binational state. Now some say that's okay. Well, okay. If you think Israel being a binational state is okay, you have a different view than I have.
A little bit more to the question I asked. So while you have privileged information to know that they're taking knives out of lockers and they're making an effort to prevent the stabbings, why can't we, the United States of America, with our influence, tell the leadership, including Abbas, Abu Mazen, to make a public statement? Because what you're telling us tonight is not making it on CNN, it's not making it in the New York Times, it's not making it on Fox. And without that information, we are continuing to be looked upon, we, the Israelis, as the bad people, as the people not willing to negotiate, as the, you know, while we here at least acknowledge that we're victims to this intifada, we have the ability, the United States, that being, to force a public statement.
Well, I don't know if we have the ability to force it. We can try. That doesn't mean you're
going to. How much are we giving the PA every year?
Right now, the amount that we give has gone down. But let's say we cut it off. Do you think?
I'm not suggesting cutting it off, but if we're giving,
look, Abu Mazen, if you look like you're trying to dictate to him, he will stand up and say no. Okay?
Publicly.
Yeah.
Why not privately?
No, look. Let me answer the question.
Okay.
The question's a fair question. The challenge is, how do you get them to do what they need to do that they're not doing? Now, we, and particularly this administration, until the Kerry speech, you didn't even hear us talk about incitement. What we have to do is make it a public issue. I'm saying, you know, even though I just said you can't dictate and tell him what to do because he'll stand up and say no, like he's resisting you. What I'm saying is, you make it a public issue. You repeat it. You go to the Europeans and you say, the biggest donors to the PA is not us. It's Europe.
Right.
And you say, there has to be a public posture that this is unacceptable. And we should be repeating this over and over again, in public. We can go to them in private and say, the right way to do it is go to them in private and say, if you don't do this, you're leaving us no choice. We have to go public. I would like us to do that. I don't have an expectation he'll immediately respond. But I want to create a climate where it becomes more and more understood and heard that basically the Palestinians are continuing to create a climate where it's okay because you call people martyrs, you name squares after people who do it, you provide funding to the families of those who, you know, carry out efforts, carry out terror or get killed in the process. That needs to be something that you make a very public issue, even if it's not going to change their behavior immediately.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Since the 1995 Jerusalem Embassy Act, several presidents have committed to moving the embassy from Tel Aviv, the American embassy, to Yerushalayim. There's bipartisan support in Congress. Why should we back off the move just because of the threat of violence? Shouldn't we stick to our commitment and do what is right regardless? You mentioned Secretary of State John Kerry. He himself is inciting the Arab world to anti-Jewish and anti-Israel violence. In an interview with Daniel Martin on CBS, quote, by moving the embassy, there'll be an explosion in the region. Israel is the only nation on earth where the U.S. embassy is not in its capital. The question to you, should we move it?
Look, should the embassy be in Jerusalem? Should have been there a long time ago, right? Of all, but
you knew that was coming.
Jerusalem is an emotional issue for everyone. Having a rational response, I can give you an explanation of how this should be done. What I can tell you, you shouldn't just move it because you don't know what the reaction is going to be. Look, anybody who says they know what the reaction is going to be, they don't know what the reaction is going to be. But I told the students upstairs, in 1929, Haji Amin al-Husseini, the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem, created a handbill with Star of David on top of the Dome of the Rock. And it produced riots throughout, completely untrue, right? Produced riots throughout all of Palestine, a massacre of the Jewish community, destruction of the Jewish community in Hebron that had been there for 800 years. 1996, the mayor of Jerusalem was Ehud Olmert. And Olmert decided that the tunnels that existed, where tourists go, he wanted to unseal one of the outlets in the old city, in the souk, not near the Temple Mount, not near the Haram al-Sharif. The Israeli security establishment was against doing it. Olmert persuaded the then Prime Minister Netanyahu to unseal it. It triggered riots for a week. 17 members of the IDF were killed in the riots around Joseph's tomb in Nablus. I was a negotiator at the time. I worked for a week to stop this. In the end, I came up with the idea we needed to create a sense of drama and invite Arafat, Netanyahu, Hussein, and Mubarak to the White House, and that created a pause. 60 Palestinians were killed, hundreds were wounded. This was a, you know, unsealing this. It didn't threaten anything. It didn't really change a reality, because the tunnels existed anyway. But those who want to exploit emotions related to Jerusalem can easily create false impressions. So what I'm saying to you is, if you're gonna move the embassy, you gotta prepare the ground. You don't just do it. Now, how would I suggest going about doing it? I would say the following. One, you say that nobody questions whether West Jerusalem will be part of Israel. Nobody. Anybody who questions it is questioning whether Israel should exist. So if no one questions whether West Jerusalem should be part of Israel, then we should be able to say we will move the embassy to West Jerusalem. This is a statement about that. It is not a statement about the ultimate disposition of Jerusalem, which still should be negotiated. So you're not preempting the ultimate status. Look, you can object to it, but the...
Guys,
there are certain facts that you can live with, or there are certain facts you can reject. Going back to Camp David, going back to the Oslo process, Jerusalem was a permanent status issue whose ultimate status was to be resolved through negotiations. If you want the embassy to be in Jerusalem, one of the ways to do it is to prepare the ground, repeat the mantra. We are going to move our embassy to West Jerusalem because nobody questions whether West Jerusalem is going to be part of Israel. The ultimate status, we still believe, should be negotiated. Now, if you do that, I would even recommend, before you do that, you don't say that publicly, although you can say that publicly, but you should go to the Arabs, at least each of those who have an equity in this, and say, we intend to move during the course of the Trump administration to the embassy. Here's what we're going to say about it. If there are things that we could frame, if there are suggestions you have for how we could frame this differently, again, to ensure that there's a rational response to this, not an emotional response to this, tell us what that might be. Prepare the ground. Look, the key to doing this is to recognize that there will be those who want to exploit it for their own purposes. And what you want to do is make it harder for them to do that.
Thank you. Next question. During the Camp David summit in 2000, Clinton, Ehud Barak, and Yasser Arafat, the offer on the table was all of Gaza, 97% of Yehuda and Shomron, a capital in East Jerusalem, right of return for quote-unquote refugees, and a $30 billion fund to compensate these refugees. Arafat rejected the offer. You speak volumes about this. What more can they realistically expect? Because they're always going to look back at that deal and say, we want either that or better. And that doesn't look very likely.
Look, Olmert offered more in 2008.
You mind clarifying?
No. In 2008, Olmert offered Abu Mazen, on the territory at least, he offered more. Because what you described was the Clinton parameters, the one thing that wasn't right, the refugees were not given a right of return. They were given a right of return to their state, not to Israel. That's an important distinction.
Okay.
All right.
The state that would become.
Yes, a right of return to their state, not to Israel.
And $30 billion to help relocate.
We talked about creating a $20 to $30 billion fund. Now, Olmert, with the territory, you had it right. It was Gaza, and it was roughly, we talked about a 4 to 6% annexation and a 1 to 3% swap in the West Bank. Olmert offered what was a 6.3% annexation and a 5.8% swap, with a 0.5% difference to be made up in terms of the safe passage between Gaza and the West Bank. And it wasn't accepted. Actually, there was no response. The answer to your question is, we haven't had Palestinians who have ever been able to say yes. We have had a Palestinian national movement that has always focused on symbols, not on substance. You've had one Palestinian leader, then Prime Minister Fayyad, who focused on substance and said we should take a page from the Zionist playbook and say, let's build our state from the ground up, which is in fact what should be done. The focus should be much more on building from the ground up. We don't need another failed state in the Middle East right now. So there should be institution building for the Palestinians. They should prepare the ground. Now, you know, when you ask what more can they expect, the answer is they can't expect more. The question is, are they prepared to actually have two states for two peoples? One of the issue that has become more prominent has been accepting Israel as the state of the Jewish people. The Palestinians have a very hard time doing that, because that requires accepting a couple things. One, it requires accepting that the Jewish people are a people. And as a people, they have a right.
As opposed to a religion.
As opposed to a religion. The Palestinians want to say it's a religion and not a people. Well, the Jewish people, as I co-chair something called the Jewish People Planning Institute. There is such a thing in Jerusalem. There is such a thing as a Jewish people. There is such a thing as a national movement, a national liberation movement for the Jewish people. That was Zionism. This is a conflict about two national movements competing for the same space. The only way you're going to reconcile it is by having two states for two peoples. That's the logic. Now, the Palestinians at some point have to be prepared to accept that if you're going to have that outcome. At this point, they like to draw the distinction and say, well, we did the recognition in 1993, the exchange of letters. But they have, in a sense, never really accepted the idea that there is a Jewish people that has a right to a state of their own. And the potential for peace will go up dramatically when the Palestinians adopt that position.
Thank you. Before I open up to the floor, there's a couple of more that I want to get to. You talk about building a foundation. You talk about leadership that will accept certain things that have never been accepted in the 60 years plus. And that leads me to the next question. And this is a really concerning issue when you think about it. Arab youths are taught violence and murder leads to martyrdom. They're taught that Jews and Israelis are descendants of apes and pigs, and hatred that begins in the kindergarten. We've all seen the videos. This is fact. How can we hope that one day there will be a movement, a leader willing to take bold steps and address the Jewish people and our Zionist movement if Arafat wasn't the guy and Abbas is not the guy? Who is? I mean, you're talking about a secession plan. Who's next? And beyond that person, because right now they're not prepared to accept the state. We need to believe that there is a fundamental change in the works amongst the youth, because the youth is the future. These will be our neighbors regardless. How can we address that issue?
Well, I think there is a fundamental need for that, for sure. There needs to be a kind of overhaul in terms of education and socialization. I think it's not something that you create overnight, because we've seen a socialization process for the last couple of decades that is just the opposite. But I do think, it does come with leadership, but it also comes with, to the extent to which you have, there are Palestinians who are out there who are prepared to promote that kind of understanding. One of the things that's required is they need recognition from Palestinian leaders. One of the things that Abu Mazen does, he'll meet the peace camp from Israel. I'd like him to meet Palestinian peace activists. Because if you meet Palestinian peace activists, you're legitimizing what they do. And there are them. They exist. They're small numbers, but they exist.
Not a popular approach.
It's not a popular approach.
The man wants to be elected, wants to remain popular.
Well, he's in the 13th year of a 5-year term, so... I think that I drew a distinction between Arafat and Abu Mazen. I said that Arafat had the capability but not the intention. I said that Abu Mazen had the intention but not the capability. I would like to see Abu Mazen do what I just said. Have him meet with those Palestinians who emphasize coexistence. Today there's an anti-normalization movement among the Palestinians. And that anti-normalization movement, anytime a Palestinian wants to go and meet with Israelis, he's under pressure. There should be a deliberate statement from Abu Mazen against that. And there should be a recognition, a readiness to meet with those Palestinian peace activists who want to promote peace. It's great for him to see those from the Israeli peace movement. How about meeting those Palestinians who emphasize that? That invests them with a kind of authority. It invests them with a kind of legitimacy. You talk about education. We do have one leader right now in the Middle East who is redoing the textbooks, and that's Sisi in Egypt. Now, he's doing other things that are not, on the human rights front that are raising questions, but this he has done that is different. A year ago, during Ramadan, for the first time, during Ramadan, when people are fasting during the day, so this is when all the soap operas, people stay home and they watch the soap operas. A year ago, they had a soap opera on a Jewish family in 1948, and what it was like, something never been done before. So there are these small indicators of some change.
But you don't see it in amongst the Palestinians.
No,
Without
I agree
a
with
change
it.
Of textbook and without a fundamental change in the education system, we're talking about 20, 30, 40 years, maybe longer, before we see or hope to see a leader that's willing to take the proper steps. So here we are, we're talking about peace and this utopian idea.
when there isn't a person on the other side of the table with whom we can speak that could realistically accept peace and maintain the peace amongst his people?
Well, look, one of the things I said, do the things I just said that sends a certain kind of signal. Do more to change the textbooks. Do more, create, I had a couple years ago, I came up with a set of parallel ideas. One of the problems today is that, just to give you, you're focused on how the Israelis see the Palestinians, but I should tell you how the Palestinians see the Israelis. It's a conflict. So the polls, the Palestinian polls, 82% of the Palestinian public believes that Israel wants to expel all Palestinians from the West Bank and take all the land. 82%. You have to find a way to address that, too, on both sides. So 64% of the Israeli public believes the Palestinians are committed to their rejection and want to replace them. What I'm saying is there have to be ways to begin to address the sources of disbelief on both sides. People have always asked me, when you're trying to resolve this conflict, I've often been asked, I gave a speech, just to tell you a story. In 2005, I went to Gaza and I gave a speech. This was 5 months before the Israelis pulled out. And unbeknownst to me,
which part of Gaza?
Out of Gaza.
Which part? Is it the Jewish part, Gush Katif part, speaking?
Israel withdrew from Gaza in 2005.
Before they pulled out?
5 months before they withdrew from Gaza.
So he's speaking to Jewish communities?
No, I was speaking to the Palestinians.
Okay, I wasn't clear.
All right, I'm being clear now.
Okay.
So, I spoke to about 300 Palestinians. Unbeknownst to me, the person who had invited me, and I wasn't part of the government at that time, this is during the Bush administration, I was part of Bush 41, not Bush 43. And I see, as I walk up, I see Mahmoud Zahar, one of the founders of Hamas. And I turn to my host, and before I can say anything, he says, "We thought it would be good if the opposition heard you as well." Which I thought, well, gee, that's nice, thanks for telling me. This is an audience, and I say to them, look, historically, you've never been in a position where you could shape your own destiny. You know, 1948, the Arabs said, they'd handle this. Arafat said to me when we were at Camp David that he actually wanted to go to the original Camp David, but the Syrians and the Soviets prevented him. So I said, here's a time. The Israelis are going to get out. You have a chance to turn Gaza into something. And if you do, it isn't just the world, but you'll see the Israeli public will say, okay, it works. And they'll say, if it works here and you behave this way and you turn it into something, then they'll say it can be applied to the West Bank too. But if you turn Gaza into a platform for attacks, if you turn it into a haven for terrorists, who's going to say, gee, let's take that failed model and apply it? So this is in your hands. Not up to us, it's in your hands. Now, what was their response, the audience response to me? The response was not to address what I raised, but to say, America can't be an honest broker. Now, so let me finish. So I said, well, first of all, if you're being honest, you don't want an honest broker. You want someone on your side. That's what you want. That's what you're really saying. I said, this is 2005. I said, for the last 4 years, the Bush administration hasn't been a broker at all. Not honest, not dishonest, hasn't been a broker at all, withdrew from the effort of peacemaking. Nothing prevented the Europeans from coming in and playing this role. Nothing prevented the Russians from coming in and playing the role, but they didn't, because they couldn't. You don't need a broker who can't do anything. You need an effective broker. And I said, the U.S. will always have a special relationship with Israel. That is not something that's against your interests, because it's the U.S. that is able to influence Israel. Now, obviously, an effective broker means you have to be able to meet the needs of both sides. There's no deal where you meet the needs of only one side. That's not a deal. So, our role in the future still is to try to find ways to affect the behavior of both, because you need an understanding of both.
Now, can we today get the Palestinians to adopt the kind of changes educationally, which is really what you're talking about? You know, the short answer is it won't be easy, but it should be one of the objectives of the new administration. The new administration should basically say, look, we want to have a relationship with the Palestinians. Here's some of the things we require, though. You want some things from us, this is what we want from you.
Thank you. Irving, you want to open up the question? Okay, does anybody else have any questions? Oh, wow, look at that. Thank you, and I thought I covered all of the ground. All right, Eddie Shabbat. Oh, I'm sorry, we have a roaming mic, Eddie, sorry, so you want to give him the first, thank you.
Thanks for your service, Mr. Ambassador, and for your erudite clarification of the issues confronting us in the Middle East today. My personal opinion is that what's going on between the Palestinian leadership and Israel is less about peace and less about land, less about geopolitics, than it is about money. The Palestinian leadership has made billions and billions of dollars with which they've lined their pockets by perpetuating a state of war. Like any other hugely successful business enterprise, from Apple to Samsung to General Motors, why would they put themselves out of business?
That was my next question.
It's an interesting observation, but I'll, today, just to put you, to create a sense of perspective, today in the, again, I talked about polling among Palestinians. 80% of the Palestinian public in the West Bank believes that the PA is corrupt. 66% would like Abu Mazen to leave. There's a deep alienation from their leaders, and by the way, it's true in Gaza as well. You get the flip side of the polling in Gaza, shows that's the view of Hamas. Now, if they want to make themselves more and more alienated from their own public, which sooner or later may express itself in some real resistance to them, then they won't change course. In the end, you know, whatever has been good for them up to now, it may not be good for them over time.
Is Jeff, that mic out?
Over here. To your over there. Left.
My left. Okay, Irving, go ahead.
Hi. You mentioned about some of the failed countries in the Middle East. Some of them were failed attempts by the U.S. to nation build.
Yeah.
If we have a two-state solution, part of that will involve nation building again. We fail time and time again. How do you see us building a nation of Palestine as something that could be successful when we failed so many times before?
Well, what you've identified as failure is when we went in, decided to change a regime, and we assumed the responsibility for building that state. We cannot do nation building from the outside. When I talked about what's going on in Saudi Arabia, the impulse for change isn't coming from us, it's coming from within. Nation building works when you have those people within that nation who are determined to build it. When you had Salam Fayyad as the Prime Minister of the Palestinian Authority, he wanted to put a focus on, in a sense, building a state through institutions. If you want to succeed, ultimately, in state building with the Palestinians, the focus, therefore, needs to be with the international community working with those among the Palestinians who are prepared to take the actions that are needed to build institutions and infrastructure. So it's not, we're not going to succeed in building from the outside, but we can join with those who are determined on the inside to do so. And I think there's a potential. There is a serious and effective Palestinian business community. Working with them is important. And identifying those who are prepared to actually do what is necessary in terms of institution building. Here again, it should be, you know, it's not only what we say in terms of incitement, we should also say what if you, you know, we can create an approach to assistance. Our assistance, you asked me about our assistance, we don't provide cash anymore. We do project assistance, which is the right way to do it with the Palestinians. So we could also create a set of incentives with regard to assistance that, you know, we can go beyond project assistance and they could be provide some cash if they create the kind of transparency
if they adopt the kind of postures that creates a high level of confidence that this will be used for the purposes intended. But the key to this is ultimately the Palestinians have to want to build a state. That's why I say we need, the Palestinian national movement has to get away from focusing exclusively on symbols and get to building a state. You know, you go back, David Ben-Gurion's response to the Balfour Declaration was, this is all very nice, but it's not going to build our state.
Thank you. Our...
Hi, my name is Michael Michon. Ambassador Ross, I wanted to ask, with what's going on in Syria and Russia taking a leading role, I've read that they, their Air Force knows what's going on in Israel. What can you tell us about relations between Israel and Russia? Netanyahu's gone to Moscow, I understand, more than a few times. What can you let us know about how Israel sees itself vis-a-vis Russia and its position now?
Look, it's an important question. I would say it's a kind of instrumental relationship. What I mean by that is there's a deconfliction that has been established, but it was established by the Israelis also conveying to the Russians at a certain point. You know, there was one point where Russian air defenses locked onto Israeli aircraft. The Israelis didn't fire on them, but the Israelis communicated that this is the sort of thing that wouldn't be accepted again. One of the reasons I think Prime Minister Netanyahu began to go see Putin was to avoid any potential, misunderstandings or inadvertent conflict. They opened what amounts to a kind of hotline, and that hotline has been used to ensure no accidents and a kind of deconfliction. So that does exist. But as you also saw, it doesn't translate into any diplomatic responsiveness on the part of the Russians. You know, people understandably were critical of the administration for abstaining on the Security Council resolution. Well, 14 countries on the Security Council didn't abstain. They said yes. Russia was one of them. And you can count on the fact anytime you have a diplomatic approach in the Security Council, the Russians will be on the wrong side of it. So the relationship that has been created with Russia is a practical one, but it doesn't translate diplomatically.
We're back
in. And can I just add one last point? I said it earlier. Much more needs to be done with the Russians on what's happening in Syria. And I don't mean, you know, I don't mean about the character of the war, because the Russians have made it pretty clear they were prepared to engage in a scorched earth approach, which they did. The question is, why would the Russians have it in their interest to abet Iranian power and in effect be supporting Iran in the broader struggle of the balance of power in the region? And I think the Russians also need to know, and this is something I hope that the new administration will convey, we won't tolerate an Iran with Hezbollah creating a new front against Israel in the Golan Heights. I mean, Israel can communicate to the Russians, but we should communicate that to the Russians.
Irv?
Hi. So I'm part of the Sabra Institute. My name is Estelle. So you have a lot of great ideas of what we could do regarding the Sunnis and everything. And I was wondering whether or not you have Mr. Trump's ear to tell him like how to address all these problems.
Well, you mind if I follow up with an additional question?
Sure.
I was gonna ask it later. Have you been contacted by Mr. Trump or his people, and or have you been invited to join his administration in any way?
No and no. Look, I'm hoping that these are ideas that will be picked up by people within the administration. I do a lot of writing. I do write a lot of articles, and I'm trying to get this out there as a way to think about it. I do know, I knew Mattis from when I was in the Obama administration. He was head of CENTCOM. I do think some of these ideas are the kind of things that would very much appeal to Mattis, the Secretary of Defense. I don't know, you know, we'll have to see if it appeals to some of the other people around Trump.
Hi, A.B. Sharma. Thank you very much for coming out tonight. I look forward to reading the book. Other than the two-state solution, maybe you could share with us what your most practical solution is. And secondly, I'm a big believer that behavior is driven by incentives. So what are the appropriate incentives that the Palestinians really need to move forward and come to the table? And who in the Arab world is kind of pulling the strings or leading the charge or driving your decision making? Thank you.
A lot of questions.
You got all those?
Yeah, you got a lot. You packed in a lot there. So, first, I don't see any easy alternative to a two-state outcome. The reason I say that is because you do have two national movements. You have two national identities. Look at the Middle East. There is no state in the Middle East where you have more than one identity that isn't at war. And I'm afraid that as long as that's the case, you know, the idea that you can that you could have a binational state that is stable and at peace, I think, is dubious. A one-state outcome, I think, as I said, is runs afoul of the fact that you have more than one identity, national identity. You know, there have been other options that were tried in the past. The idea, you know, there used to be something called the Jordan option. The Jordanians, the only way a Jordan option works is if Jordan has an interest in it. They've made it very clear they don't. So, you know, the problem we face is that you can't produce a two-state outcome soon, but you need to find a way to preserve it as a possibility. So my own position on that is I would like to see the Israelis build only within the settlement blocks, not outside the settlement blocks. Now, you can't, today you don't have a common definition of what's a settlement block. One of the main problems I had with the Security Council Resolution 2234 was that since the year 2000, we came up, and I was involved with this, we came up with an idea for how you could try to resolve the border. And that produced the idea of settlement blocks and swaps. So in about 5% of the West Bank, you can accommodate about 75% of the settlers. And so you can have a kind of blocks and then swaps as a way of getting to that at some point. The language in this resolution calls all settlement activity beyond June 4, 67 a flagrant violation of international law. Well,
including East Jerusalem,
yes,
and the Western Wall.
Right.
There's a problem with that.
You don't have to tell me. I wrote an article explicitly on this.
So would you have not abstained and rejected the resolution if you were the commander chief?
I would have vetoed it.
Okay.
But first of all, Egypt pulled the resolution. Clearly, there was a signal from the administration.
The next administration.
No, but I'm saying clearly, no. Egypt pulled the resolution the next day
because of Trump. It was Trump's influence to pull it, and then four other nations.
Leave that to the side.
Okay.
Egypt, I'm making a separate point. Egypt pulled the resolution. We had New Zealand, Malaysia, Senegal, and Venezuela bring it back the next day. Had the Obama administration made it clear it was against it, would those four countries have brought it back the next day? No. So that means the administration, in a sense, not only abstained and allowed it to happen, it meant that it was sending signals that it wanted to happen. Now, what that makes for me, that makes what happened even less understandable. If you wanted it to happen because you wanted to show there's a price for settlement activity, I could accept that, but not with the language that was there. The language that was there makes it harder to produce settlement blocks because you're saying they all represent a flagrant violation of international law. One. Two. It makes June 4, 67 the default position on the border. Our position going back again to Camp David was 67 and mutually agreed swaps, meaning by definition, June 4, 67 cannot be the border. Why would you now allow language that makes June 4, 67 the default position? The administration had enormous leverage to affect the language. You're right, you want the resolution because you're angry at Bibi, you're angry at the settlements. Okay, put language in that preserves the possibility of producing an agreement later on. Don't put language in that is going to complicate the task for any subsequent administration that wants to get this done. This was a terrible resolution that has terrible language that should not have become a resolution. Now, again, getting back to your question, you got me on a roll. So I would like to see, since you can't define the blocks today, but you do have the security barrier. The security barrier is on about 8% of the West Bank. So if Israel would build within that 8%, but not build outside it, then Israel would be in a position where it does several things. It would say, first of all, we're demonstrating we're committed to two states, because we're not building a 92% of the West Bank, which would be the Palestinian state. Secondly, Israel's preserving itself. It's showing it's preserving itself, so it won't become a binational state. It's preserving the option of a state later on by not building outside. So I would like to see Israel do that, number one. Now, I would like to see the new administration work with Israel to take advantage of that, to then try to produce something from the Arabs, from the Europeans, and maybe from the Palestinians as well. Again, to change the realities now, to change the dynamic, to begin a process where you begin to recreate a sense of possibility. You can't produce peace now, but maybe you can restore a sense of possibility so that something becomes possible later on. In terms of your answer on the critical question is, are there Arab states at this point who are prepared to invest in something like this? The answer is, I don't know. And I'm not sure. That's one of the reasons I said probe it quietly. And one of the reasons I'm not sure is because they're consumed with everything else. They're not thinking about the Palestinians. They're focused, the states in the Arabian Peninsula are focused on Iran. Egypt and Jordan are dealing with, you know, ISIS and ISIS-related derivatives. So these are immediate priorities and preoccupations. Do they care about the Palestinian issue in the abstract? Are they prepared to do something about the Palestinian issue? I don't know. I don't know. The issue of the Jerusalem embassy will reduce their interest in wanting to do something because it'll create problems for them. I mean, it cuts both ways. You raise the Jerusalem embassy, suddenly the one issue that makes them pay attention to the Palestinians is Jerusalem, because that could be a mobilizing issue for their publics. And they can't look like they're indifferent, or it can't look like they acquiesce. So they may feel they have to do something, but the question is, will it be positive or negative? So I don't know. The short answer is, I don't know. Again, people who claim they know just what's going to happen, they don't know what's just going to happen. But it's the uncertainty that also can be a source of alarm. So I don't know whether there is a level of interest to do something on this issue, but I would probe it in quiet and behind the scenes and discreetly, and I would see.
Thank you. Errol, I'm getting signals here. Are we stealing second? Okay. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. I have a feeling we could have stayed with questions all night, but we have to bring the evening to a close. We'd like to thank Ambassador Ross for being here. I have a short list to thank, and the program will continue, and we'll hear some very inspiring words before we break, so please remain seated. We'd like to thank our Rabbi Chaim, Rabbi Eisenkot, for helping to organize this evening. Our president, our new president, Juma Katan, Sally Haber, who arranged the evening, Irving Safdie, who's doing remarkable work in our community, Jack Dweck, Jeffrey Dweck, A.B. Franco, who played guitar for us, Eliyahu Sion, who sang along, Deborah Copeland-Smith, our moderator, Jack Indy, for inspiring us, Jacqueline Mamie, Max Shem Tov, and Samantha Shabbat. We're a group here. Thank you. We're a group here that sees the state of Israel as an open miracle in our day. We're a group here that staunchly believes the state of Israel is our right. And it's a credit to our community to listen to the views that are facing the administrations of this government for the last 60 years. So I thank you for your cooperation, and I thank Ambassador Ross for sharing this insight with us and helping us to understand the challenges that exist. So, you know, we come from a Judaic Arab culture. And 50, 60 years ago, this room might have been loaded with Arab-speaking Jews. We balance a culture. We balance our love of Israel. We balance all of that. And there's a skill that we've acquired in time. A few thousand years of this balance, a give and take, a hit or run, a roll of the dice. We don't really count on luck. We see our number coming up. So in your skillful mastery of the politics of that region, we have a gift for you. It's a rectangular box that most might be familiar with. Please master the art of backgammon.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite two young people to come up. These are students of the Sabra Institute. Naomi Sanders and Shlomo Hushny, please join us.
Thank you, Ambassador. That was a very nice speech. So just to introduce, the Sabra Institute is an educational program for high school seniors that's aimed at providing us with the tools necessary to confront and oppose any anti-Israel opposition groups, I guess, on college campuses next year. So the group operates primarily by providing us with a cogent and well-balanced historical narrative of the Arab-Israeli conflict, which helps us combat any kinds of opposition from our adversaries. The program also features multiple hands-on and interactive lessons from community members and litigants on topics such as public speaking and debating, which helps us effectively convey our position to our opposition on college campuses. The program also culminates in a week-long trip to Israel, where we will tour sites that are crucial to understanding the conflict and its underpinnings, such as the Golan Heights in the north, and also the security fence in the West Bank. Yes, so thank you.
Hi, my name is Naomi Sanders. I just want to talk about what the Sabra Institute really does for us as students and for people who are going to take on the real world next year. So what the Sabra Institute does for my peers and I is that it lets us channel our passion for Israel into more than just emotions. We get to have a voice. Sources online tell the average reader that they're getting the real truth, but really they're just getting biased opinions and skewed facts. Even in Jewish day schools, we don't get enough exposure to the issues at hand or the arguments that we're going to face in the real world. Israel's history is a complicated subject. There are facts, there are fictions, and then there are the gray areas. Politics is messy like that. Many of us come from Zionistic homes, and it's easy for us to say that we love Israel, but what are we really standing for? Are we just being influenced by the community around us? Being exposed to both narratives gives us a deeper understanding, but it also solidifies what we believe and why we believe it. It lets us empathize and negotiate rather than getting caught in a tug of war. And more importantly, it gives us the conviction and the backing that we would need to approach and persuade others. At the age of 17, ready to go off to college in Israel next year, we are learning not just about the politics and history. We are preparing ourselves to be strong in the face of opposition. We are no longer the kids being influenced. We are the kids who know our facts, who have opinions, and who can argue them. We will become the influencers. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the evening. I'm glad you came, and Hope to see you again at the next SCA function or Beth Torah function. Good night. Also, I'd like to recognize Amanda Eskiel as well. Thank you, Amanda.